hot as it's hot out there. Welcome to heaven. hey, so we've got a great announcement this morning, and so I want to welcome some people on up here. We have, if you were here a couple months ago, we were able to vote in 3 new overseers. And so right now we're going to have them come up, and I'm going to hand it to Derek to kind of share about what that process has been like. And we're going to invite some of our former overseers up who are here for the first service. And so here you go, Derek.
All right. So good morning. I'm Derek Bergthold. And yes, as Nick said, I'm one of your overseers here. And we are the behind-the-scenes folks generally, although if you've been around any length of time, most of these faces seem familiar to you. They should. More than half of them have preached up here before, so you've heard them speak. Are you on today? Not today. Okay. Your eye was up here leading communion a little while ago. Ephraim's going to lead us today. Okay, so as Nick explained, it's a process. It's a biblical model of leadership that supports what we do in ministry. And number one, support Nick in what he does and the directions that the Spirit moves him in. So today I'm here to just basically announce the process and what's happened and where the next steps are going. So over the last several months, we've had a process of hopefully God leading us to new leadership, new oversight. We have a process where we have terms. It's a little bit loose, but some people are going out. Blanca will be departing from us. Susan's not here, but Ephraim's here. So if you know these folks well enough, you know that Blanca is departing because Riddis over here is taking her spot, and they are husband and wife. So, and additionally, Susan is departing because Ephraim, Susan's spouse, is stepping in as well. So people that have been behind the scenes at the church for many years, familiar faces to all of us, and we welcome Uriah, Ephraim, and Riddis as our new church council members. Blanca will be taking a break from that. Susan will be taking a break from that. And Charlie Del Bosque will be taking a break from that for a time. We are working on a process of deacons, which is also a biblical model. Some of us will be going into perhaps deacon roles as we see God for next steps for us and the congregation in general. So as we bring more people into leadership, as we try to be more obedient to God and how he's called us to serve, those are some of the things that are going on behind the scenes. So you don't get a chance too often to see the overseers here, the church council, as we're sometimes called. But here we are. So you're always welcome to talk to us, share with us, share what God's doing in your lives. That's part of our role, is supporting you, supporting our leadership. I'd like to call up the staff, too, as we're going to pray over our new leaders here. And maybe just have, as many of our leaders, also if you're in any kind of a ministry leadership position out there, children's, youth, young adults, groups, whatever it might be, come on up. Now we have a tradition of extending a hand as we pray over our new leadership, as we symbolically send out the Spirit to these new overseers, Lord. So if we could extend a hand from all of us, let's pray over our 3 new overseers. Lord God, we just thank you how you move in this church. We know that you're doing amazing things. We feel alive. And we're blessed to have Nick, who provides that guidance, that oversight that we know is in touch with your Spirit and is sensitive to your leadership. I thank you for this process that's brought these new leaders on the stage here, and to be behind the scenes, to meet monthly with Nick, to take care of the things, the business, and support his leadership and help with the vision and direction of the future of the church. I just pray for these 3 individuals, Lord, that you will stir in their hearts, that you will call them to the directions that your desire is for them, that the staff, we thank you for them, Lord. We thank you for their wisdom, their insight, their guidance, their movement of the Spirit, Lord, as we continue to reach into the community and beyond. We just pray, above all else, that we will be the community that serves you and does your will. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So, thank you guys for your support. We're excited about this next season and what that looks like as we restructure. We've spent a lot of months looking biblically at how do we want to structure our church based on the Bible, and we're working diligently towards that, including that deacon's ministry that just allows people to take on these roles of leadership who are already serving and leading, but now they get to just be part of the process of creating what the future is for Redeemers. At this time, I'd love to welcome F. You just saw him, and so he's joining us. If you don't know, like, it's great to have F on overseers, but he's already been serving for years in so many different ways, but most importantly, the last couple of years, he has been overseeing our Spanish ministries, teaching over there on most Sundays, and so we are grateful to have him and his leadership even increasing here at the church. And today we combine services with our Spanish ministry, so this was a great opportunity for us to all be together and have F bless us. So, F, thank you so much. Give him a hand.
Thank you, Pastor. Can I just say that it's a challenge for me to be up here. And I'm going to share a personal story because I think it has to do with the glory of God and exalting Him. And I'm a big believer in vulnerability and transparency. There are only a few people in my world that actually know, but I wanted to share it with you because today's sermon, it's really about faith, hope, and love. So I'm taking a risk, being vulnerable, being transparent. And I think as Christians that we are called to be vulnerable, to be transparent, so that He may be great, so that He may be seen in our lives. I'm pretty complex. I'm not from here, I'm not from there. For those of you that are Latinos, you know what I mean. I was born in the great state of Texas. Woo! Go Cowboys. Right? But I grew up in California, and I am first gen Latino, Hispanic, Latinx, whatever you want to call me. Right? And that came with challenges, right? Not being Mexican enough, not being American enough. But it wasn't until I actually gave my life to Christ that my identity was renewed in Him. And throughout my educational life and adult life until recently, became aware that I struggle with several things. Number one, I struggle with being on the spectrum. And that is hard for me to share. Thank God that I have a great wife, great family. And I'm also sad because I know that I've hurt relationships in the past because of how I'm wired. And I share this with you because today's message about hope, my hope is that someday I will be perfect. And someday I will not have to struggle with the issues that I struggle with. And so with you, I share a little personal story. And it all started in 1980. So I grew up in the 80s. I would consider us to be the greatest generation ever. Yes. We took a lot of risks, right? Being bilingual, I grew up with, you know, really trying to discover these words. You know, I like, I want, I love, right? I learned me gusta. Everyone say it with me, me gusta. Look at you. You guys are already bilingual. Yo quiero. No, yo, don't say yo quiero Taco Bell. Remember that in the 80s, right? And yo amo. And in Spanish, we make a distinction between yo quiero and yo amo, right? And so these words, as we learn about love and as we've been learning about love, love is everything, right? I love to ride my bike, right? Making our own ramps, and just jumping. I was sharing with my kids the other day on 4th of July that when I was younger, we used to jump over fireworks. We were risk takers, right? We were not scared of anything. Remember the lights? Mom would say, hey, when the light turns on, it's time for you to come home. Right? This was before technology, before cell phones, before anything. And I share this with you because God has always been working in my life. Even though, as an 8-year-old, I didn't know that I was created in His image. I did not grow up in a Christian home. But I do know that all of us have experienced love, or love, right? So as an 8-year-old, there was this girl in the neighborhood that I really liked. And because we live in the agricultural capital of the world right here, I don't know if you guys knew that, but here in the Central Valley, we produce 1/4 of the nation's produce. And so my father, El Panadero, you know, the Mexican bread man that would take Mexican pastries to every door in the valley, right? People would give him grapes. And so one day, I decided that I wanted to share my love to this young, beautiful girl in our neighborhood. And so what did I do? I got some grapes. I went to her house and put them in a bag, knocked on the door, and quickly took off. Wrote a little note and said, I love you. Right? But as she saw this, I don't think she appreciated it. But it turns out that she was more impressed with the palatero, the ice cream man that would go around the neighborhood. Right? Sometimes love is knowing about what truly matters to the other person and doing something to show them. So being on the spectrum, that can be difficult for me. But I'm learning, even as a 51-year-old man. So in our lives as Christians, love has everything to do with it. And we can't hurry it. Love is the greatest commandment, and it is the essence of our faith. So today we want to explore how faith, hope, love are not just words, but rather they are verbs, they are actions that can transform our lives and the world around us. So let's get started with our sermon for today, and I've entitled it, Faith That Moves, Hope That Endures, and Love That Transforms. So again, I come back to these words. In English, we say, I like you. There's a distinction between saying, I like you and I love you. I love pizza, I love the Cowboys, and I love you, Mom. But in Spanish, we make distinctions when we're telling someone, me gustas, right? I like you. Te quiero. In English, it's translated as, I love you. And then in Spanish, we say, te amo. I love you. So this word, love, is really close to my heart because in Spanish we distinguish the different levels of love. In English we use love for everything, right? So coming back to our theme in, you know, verano del amor, summer love. I want to share really quick some background knowledge in the book of Corinthians, where Paul really is challenging the church of Corinth to live in a more excellent way. He has to define what love is, and he has to remind them that we must love in agape. Everyone say it with me, agape. Right? Which is, as we've learned, this unselfish, this unconditional love for others. And so in chapter 13, has become known as the great love chapter of the Bible. So today, in our core text message this morning, which is found in verse 13 of chapter 12, today we're going to dive deep into this core, into the core values that defines us as Christians. This is the essence of who we are. or what we should strive for. You must have faith, biblical faith. We must have hope, biblical hope. And we must love biblically. So before we get started, let us stand to regard's transformative word this morning. God's word says, let me put on my glasses here. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am a what? Resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I might boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. So here's the definition of love. Biblical love. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. Ouch, right? It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, and I can't wait for that, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man or woman, I put the ways of childhood behind me. Hopefully, right? But now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. But now these three remain. Faith, hope, and love. And let's all read it together. But the greatest of these is love. Let us pray. Father, this morning we come to you humbly as a church. And we acknowledge your greatness. We acknowledge your holiness. We acknowledge that you are a transformative, loving God. We are here this morning because we are broken. We are here because we love you. We are here because we need more of you. We are here because we are not perfect. Father, use me, use these words, Lord, to be able to convey your message of faith, hope, and love. We love you and adore you, Lord, and we thank you for calling us your children. And for those of us that are still seeking, I pray that God will continue to reveal himself to you in this morning. Know that you are loved before you were even conceived. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today I have three questions for you. So turn to your neighbor and ask them, what is faith? What is hope? What is love? Now, for those of you that want to take a little language risk, say with me. ¿Qué es la fe? ¿Qué es la esperanza? And ¿qué es el amor? Good job. Give yourselves a big hand. Not bad. So again, today's sermon is titled Faith That Moves, Hope That Endures, and Love That Transforms. I want to show a quick video as we get started. So the question again for you I have is, what is faith? Take a look.
Only the leap from the lion's head, leap with his worth.
So how many of you remember this movie, right, when it came out in 1989? Again, the 80s, the greatest decade, right? So I became a Christian at August 14th, 1988. So when I saw this clip, it impacted me greatly. It's the essence of faith. First, faith is indispensable to us as believers. We know that in Hebrews, the great book of faith, right, says that now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Faith is the foundation of our relationship with God. Amen? Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. We are saved by grace through faith, and we are instructed to live and walk by faith. In other words, we cannot be Christians, followers of Christ, without faith. And I love this quote, this next quote by Anne Lamott, an American novelist. She writes that the opposite of faith is not doubt, but certainty. Certainty is missing the point entirely. Faith includes noticing the mess, the emptiness, and the discomfort, and letting it be there until some light returns. When I read this, it really impacted me, because sometimes we want to get out of the muck, right? But it's in that muck that we realize that we need God. It is in whatever your thorn is, right? Might be being on the spectrum. And that is okay. To embrace our stories, to embrace the things that we struggle, realizing that in Him my faith lies. In Him I am transformed. So faith, doubt, and it's okay to doubt, it's okay to doubt. But we must take action. These three words are part of our journey as Christians. That's why I love this video, because in this video, it's a great metaphor for faith, right? So faith in the unseen, as we saw in the scene, Indiana Jones must step out onto what appears to be an empty chasm, right? Believing that a bridge will appear to support him. He had to trust. He had to believe. This mirrors the Christian concept of faith, which involves trusting in God's promises and guidance, even when the path is not visibly clear, right? How many of us have been on this path and said, God, are you there? And sometimes He does not answer. And sometimes He just wants us to cling on to His promises. So the question is, what are those promises? Those promises are in God's Word. Again, going back to Hebrews 11:1. States, now faith is confidence, right? Confidence comes with attitude in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Second, trust and obedience. Just as Indiana had to trust in the instructions given to him by his father, we Christians are called to trust and obey God's word. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, which is one of my favorite verses, says that trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. And in all of your ways, what? Submit to Him, and He will make your path straight. Next slide. All right, thank you. All right. Next, number three, it takes courage and action. The leap requires Indiana to take a what? A courageous step into the unknown. Similarly, as in the Christian walk, which often requires us to, as believers, to take bold steps of faith. I'm taking a bold step of faith every time I have to preach. No me nace. It's not something that I like to do. But I'm obedient to God's word. God is asking you to do something. Take a step of faith and do it. Trust in Him. He will provide. He will guide you. He will give you the support that you need in order to accomplish His will, not your will. Faith by itself is not accompanied. Faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, it is dead. Number four, seeing beyond the natural belief. In the movie, the bridge becomes visible after Indiana steps out in faith. This can be seen as a metaphor for how, in the Christian life, the evidence of God's provision and support often becomes clear after we take steps of faith. Number five, dependence on God's guidance. Indiana's successful leap depends on following the Grail Diary's instructions precisely. I don't know if you saw that little book, right? It explains what he needed to do. So we as Christians believe that our success in life depends on following God's guidance and relying on His wisdom rather than on our own. So faith is not just about believing. It involves acting upon that belief. So what is it that we believe? What is it that you believe? Hebrews chapter 11 is filled with accounts of people. It gives a list of people who expressed their faith in God by obeying His word. Faith means taking God at His word and believing what He says is true. So I'm going to ask you to pull out your phones right now. Yes, I'm going to give you permission to pull out your phones, not to go on Facebook, okay, or Twitch, right? But I want you to scan this QR code as a resource. Now, for those of you that are not tech savvy, that's okay. I've included a bit.ly for you, okay? So you can write this down under your notes, bit.ly/redeemersfaith. So in here, you have some thought-provoking questions for your self-reflection. So, yes, you have homework tonight, okay, this week. I challenge you. I hope this can help you to reflect on your faith journey. Amen? So, what are some practical ways that you can actually implement your faith, how you can live out your faith daily? So, I've included three simple ways. Number one, prayer and devotion. Spend time in prayer. Prayer is simply having a conversation with God and being transparent, being vulnerable. Talk to Him. Be real with Him. You know, for kids, for teenagers, it could be, you know, encourage family devotion time, doing simple prayers, trusting in God in challenges and or uncertainties, rely on God's promises. During difficult times, the Bible's full of promises, right? It's important for us to know those promises. So it takes some reading for us to know those promises. So for kids, maybe it could be, you know, trusting God when facing school challenges, making new friends, kids, teens, young adults, just talk to God. Be vulnerable with Him. Be transparent with Him. And finally, the verb, right? Acting on God's word. This is where the rubber meets the road, because this is a challenge for many of us. I'm here, up here, because I trust in God. And I trust in His guidance. And so sometimes, by faith, I need to take a step of faith and say, God, I will follow, I will do what You have called me to do, which is to share Your love. Take steps of faith in your daily life by following God's guidance. For teens, it could mean, and for adults, right? Volunteer in church, in church activities, and help others in need. And I think as a church, we do that very well. Amen? So number two, what is hope? Right? Hope is commonly used to mean a wish. It's strength. is the strength of the person's desire, right? We all say, I hope that the Cowboys will win, right? I hope that Argentina will win this week. I want them to win the Copa America. But I'm not talking about that type of hope. I'm talking about biblical hope. It's the confident expectation of what God has promised and its strength in his faithfulness. So I have a hope. I have hope that with my imperfection, with my how I am wired physically on this earth, my hope is that someday I will be transformed into the perfect Ephraim in heaven. But for right now, I have to carry this cross. We all carry some sort of cross. We all have a thorn. Hope is often mistaken for wishful thinking or mere optimism, leading to disappointment. However, true biblical hope, however, is a confident expectation rooted, I love that word, right? Emplazado, rooted in God's promises and character. Romans 15:3 says that may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. So that, say with me, so that, and I'll say, para que, good job, you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So, this hope is dynamic, powerful, and adaptable, characterized by courage, by patience, by expectancy, and by steadfastness. Unlike uncertain worldly hope, biblical hope is certain because it is based on God's unchanging promises. Faith believes God can do. Let's all say that together, please. One, two, three. Faith believes God can do, and hope believes God will do. So to cultivate true hope, we must deepen our relationship with God. How many of you have participated in Rooted? Right? If you have not heard of Rooted, Enraizado, I encourage you to get involved, get connected to learn more about Rooted. Because we must deepen our relationship with God and with others. And must trust in his faithfulness, enabling us to face challenges. Right? We all have challenges. But with confidence and see them through the lens of God's character. That sometimes can be hard. As Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace you trust in him. And part of trust means that sometimes we have to go through that door. We have to take that action. We have to open that door and go through that door. Not knowing what's behind the door. That's scary. Because so many times we want to control our lives. We want to control our paths, right? Our direction. But God's word says, no. Right? I will guide you. I will direct your path, your steps. But we must go through that door. You are called to be different. You are called to do something. What is that calling for you? I challenge you to discover that calling. So what are some practical ways that we can practice hope? Number one, right? Focus on God's promises. Memorize, meditate on scriptures that promise hope. Maybe for you kids and teens, create a hope journal where they write or draw their hopes and prayers. I love this biblical verse about hope. It is found in Isaiah 40:31 that says, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Something else that we can do, encourage each other. And that takes fellowship. That takes connectedness. That takes vulnerability. That takes transparency, encouraging each other. Share stories. how God has transformed your lives. Share your testimonies. You know, share how God has worked in your life. For teens, maybe for you, form a group where you can support and pray for each other's hopes. And finally, let's set some goals. There's so much research out there on the importance of goal setting, especially for young people. Right? So set personal goals, align with God's plans, and work towards them. Maybe say, God, I'm going to go through that door this year, and I'm going to serve. I'm going to take that risk, and I'm going to serve. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know if I have the capacity to do it, but I trust that you will provide people, that you will provide the necessary individuals to help me with what you want me to do. And he will. He will. He will not forsake you. So please do that. Maybe for families, set family goals that include spiritual growth and acts of service. So the last word is love. So we've been learning a lot about what love is, yes? Right? The difference between te quiero and te amo, right? I'm not going to tell God, Dios te quiero. No, I'm going to tell God, Dios te amo, which means, God, I love you. I don't just like you, I love you. So, ¿qué es amor? What is love? As we learned in focusing on chapter 13, verse 13, we finally come to this profound concept of love. Paul explains, he defines what love is, but in the end, he ends with this verse, which states, and now these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So why is love considered greater than faith and hope? It is because it is the only one that will last forever. Faith will become sight, and hope will be realized. But love will endure throughout eternity. Again, agape. Say it with me. Agape. Is selfless, sacrificial, unconditional love. Man, that's a challenge, right? Especially when I'm trying to love my neighbor. It loves without changing, gives without expecting anything in return. It loves even the unlovable. It does not demand or expect payment, but gives because it wants to. Jesus emphasized love as the greatest commandment. He taught us to love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, and to what? To love our neighbors as ourselves. I love this quote by C.S. Lewis from Mere Christianity. He says, do not waste time bothering whether you love your neighbor, but act as if you did. Powerful, powerful. Whether we recognize it or not, each of us has certain priorities that guide our lives. Sometimes things hold more importance to us than others, and those most significant priorities profoundly influence our paths. These hold true for everyone, from day laborers to corporate executives. Have you ever reflected on your life to understand your priorities? For better or worse, our priorities gradually shape who we become and determine our destinies. Starting with God's perspective on priorities provides a valuable framework to discern what our true priorities should be. The Bible offers clear guidance on this matter, right? Jesus states that the foremost commandment is to what? Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. Mark 12:30. This Old Testament command forms the foundation for a relationship with God. The emphasis is all in this command. It means that we are to love God with every part of our being. That can be hard. That can be hard. Because sometimes the flesh gets in the way. Sometimes our minds get in the way. But we must take that step of faith and walk towards Him and trust in His promises. We are to become God-centered individuals, not me-centered. Placing Him above everyone and everything else. From this primary focus, all priorities will naturally align. So, how do we love this God? How do we love God? We first must come to know Him personally. We all know Him. And some of us are searching for Him. Searching for this love. Searching for this God of love. Coming to know God involves gaining true and accurate knowledge about Him. That's why it's so important for you, for us to be involved, to get into Rooted, to get into Alpha, to get into all the courses of the discipleship that we offer here in Redeemers, to grow in Him, to grow in knowledge of biblical truth. Although God has shown us something of His eternal power and divine nature in creation, Romans 1:20, it is preeminently in the Scriptures that He has given us true and accurate and detailed knowledge about Himself and His ways. The Bible basically is a love story. It's a love letter to us. Here's this God from the very beginning created the heavens and the earth, all because He wanted us to be created in His image, to love Him, to worship Him, to adore Him. And unfortunately, we are the ones that messed it up. But again, because of His grace, because of His love, He has always provided a way out, wanting to restore, wanting to reconnect with us. Loving God wholeheartedly is central to spiritual health. And the more we love Him, the healthier we become. C.S. Lewis, right, again, states that every Christian would agree that a man's spiritual health is exactly proportional to his love of God. Do you agree? Is wholehearted love for God the highest priority in our lives? Jesus teaches that God, that loving God wholeheartedly and loving our neighbor as ourselves should be our two highest priorities in life. So if we pursue these priorities with the Spirit's help, we will steadily be transformed into people of love, into a church of love, who glorify God and experience the greatest fulfillment possible in this life. So we should express love for the Lord, for our brothers and sisters in Christ, and for those who are lost. Only then we can communicate God's love to the lost and to the dying world. So what are some practical ways that we can actually show God's love? Number one, acts of kindness. Perform random acts of kindness in your community, in your neighborhood. For kids, maybe for you guys, it could be, you know, encourage a friend, help a friend, make a new friend at school this next school year. Talk to someone that, you know, sits by themselves and go up to them and say, yo, what's up? What's your name? You got Riz? What a word. Volunteering in service. Maybe get involved in Redeemers and service projects, right, that help those in need. We serve our community at Redeemers. For teens, hey, participate in different types of youth events, outreach programs, etc. Build relationships. I think this is who we are as a church, right? Connecting with each other, building relationships with each other, getting to know each other, having micro groups, you know, having Bible studies, being vulnerable, being transparent, sharing life, and realizing that life is messy and that it's okay. It is okay that life is messy. So in conclusion, to end, I want to thank you for joining us this morning. We are all on a different path, on a different journey, right? But I hope that your path and your journey will lead you to God. Know that God will open that door for you, or know that that door is there for you to open to go to God. I pray that God will guide you in this journey, that God will continue to transform your minds, your hearts, your bodies, and know that God loves you with all of your imperfections, with all of your thorns, right? God loves you. I want to pray for you this morning. If we can please stand as we close today's service. I want you to listen to this prayer that I wrote out. Because it's, I want you to be fully, fully blessed by God's love in this morning. I want to share with you, I want to give you a command. And the command is this: have faith, have hope, and have love. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude for your boundless love and grace. As we reflect on the powerful words of 1 Corinthians 13, we ask your divine presence to guide us in embodying the virtues of faith, hope, and love in our daily lives, in our daily conversations. Lord, grant us a faith that moves mountains, unwavering and steadfast, even in the face of challenges and uncertainties. Help us to trust in your promises and to take bold steps of obedience, knowing that you are always with us. Fill us with a hope that endures, a hope that is rooted in your unchanging character and eternal promises. In moments of despair or doubt, remind us of the hope we have in Christ, a hope that gives us strength and courage to persevere. And above all, Lord, let your love transform us. Teach us to love unconditionally with patience and kindness, reflecting your perfect love to everyone, even those that we detest, even those that we do not like. Everyone, Lord, that we encounter. May our actions and words be a testament to the love that never fails, the love that always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Pray that our faith, hope, and love will not only transform our lives, but also touch the lives of those around us and our communities around us, Lord, bringing glory to your name. May we live out these virtues daily, making a positive impact in our families, communities, and our country, and beyond. In Jesus' name. Again, have faith, have hope, have love. God bless.
Sing with me. You came to the world you created, trading your crown for a cross. Your innocent life paid the cost. Counting your status as nothing, the King of all kings came to serve, washing my feet and covering me with your love. If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you is all I need. Take everything. And my treasure, the one that I can't live without. Here at your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down. Oh, here at your feet, my desires and dreams I lay down. If
stay cool today.